One application of vectors is to model a force acting on an object of some mass. You could have multiple forces acting on an object, in which case we say the net force is the sum, the vector sum, of all of those vectors. Let's look at some examples. Suppose I have an object whose mass is 2 kilograms, which is experiencing a constant downward force due to gravity. So here's my object, it's 2 kilograms, and it's being pulled downwards because of gravity. Now the force downwards due to gravity, from Newton's second law, that's mass times acceleration due to gravity. The mass of this object is 2 kilograms, and then the acceleration due to gravity is approximately -9.8 meters per second squared. Some people like -9.81 a little bit more. And then we use a negative sign to indicate that the motion is downwards. The object is in a constant horizontal force field, or perhaps it's just wind or something like that. And this force has a magnitude of 4 newtons. The way I've sketched this, this force is just pointing to the right. The fact that its magnitude is 4 newtons tells us that this force should be modeled as 4, 0. So the magnitude of that force vector is 4, that gives us the 4 newtons, and it's pointing us in that direction. The net force acting on this object is just the vector sum of these two. So the net force is that horizontal force I just sketched plus the force downwards due to gravity. Now we just do a basic vector sum. So it's 4, 0 plus 0, -19.6. Therefore, the net force acting on this object can be represented as the vector 4, negative 19.6. Notice the horizontal component of the force is in the x coordinate, the vertical component of the force is in the y coordinate, and they don't interact. They're separate components. We're going to use that in the next example. Now let's consider a 5 kilogram object, which I've hung asymmetrically from a ceiling using 2 cords. The cord on the left we'll call cord 1. And the way I've set this up, I didn't use the same length or something like that, this cord makes an angle of 60 degrees with the ceiling. The cord on the right that I'm calling cord 2, that makes an angle of 30 degrees with the ceiling. Well, each of these cords is exerting a force on this object. We want to find the magnitude of that force. Now, if you're just looking at this object that I've hung from the ceiling, you don't see a third force acting on this object, but there's a downward force due to gravity. So now when we consider the net force acting on this object, we're going to have a force that goes along cord 1, pointing along cord 1 up towards the ceiling. We'll have a force that points along cord 2, and then we have a force pointing us straight down due to gravity. We'd like to find the lengths of the forces along cords 1 and 2. To set this problem up, what we're going to need to do is describe each of these 3 forces. The forces along cords 1 and 2, and the force downwards due to gravity, we need to find the components of these forces. So some people are really good at kind of adjusting angles. I always have to have a sort of origin where I measure angles off of. So let's treat the object like the origin. And then I'm going to recognize that this angle I've just sketched here is 60 degrees because it's alternate interior with this angle up here. Likewise, over here, this is 30 degrees based on this 30 degrees up here. Okay, so that's going to help us find the coordinates for the forces along cords 1 and 2. And then for gravity, once again, that's going to be mass times acceleration. Once again, the mass is 5 kilograms, and then the acceleration downwards due to gravity is -9.8. Let's look more closely at cord 1. To set this up, I always encourage you to realize that a vector has 2 properties. It has a length and it has a sense of direction. So if I can't just write down the vector right away, perhaps I can decompose it into the product of its magnitude times a unit length vector pointing us in the same sense of direction. Well, the magnitude of that vector is what we're asked to find. So if I already knew it, it wouldn't be a very good problem. So let's just call the magnitude of that force that points us along chord 1. Let's just call that T1 for tension 1. And then for the sense of direction, I would like to have a unit length vector so that when I do the magnitude times the sense of direction, I don't mess up the magnitude, right? So I'd like for the magnitude of the vector at the end of the day to be T1 So when I multiply that magnitude times the sense of direction, I don't want to change that. So that sense of direction needs to be given by unit length vector. Now with these angle problems, your unit length vector is going to come from sines and cosines. So in particular, if my object is at the origin, then this dashed line to the right is like the positive x-axis. So over here, this is like the negative x-axis. So what angle is this chord making with the positive x-axis? Well, it's making an angle of 180 minus 60. It's the supplement of the angle 60 degrees. So a unit vector that points in this direction would be cosine 120, sine 120. So that means that the force that points us along chord 1 can now be represented as the product of the magnitude times the sense of direction. So it's T1 times the vector cosine 120, sine 120. It's the exact same idea for chord 2. The angle is even easier because it's labeled on the picture. We'll think of the force pointing us in the direction of chord 2 as the product of its magnitude, which is an unknown tension, let's call it T2, times the sense of direction. And that we can read right off the picture, it's cosine 30, sine 30. We've already identified the force downwards due to gravity, so we can go ahead and add these together to get the net force acting on this object. It's just a vector sum, so we just go component by component and add them together. For my x coordinates, it's T1 cosine 120 plus T2 cosine 30 plus 0. That's from gravity. And then for my y components, it's T1 sine 120 plus T2 sine 30, and then minus 5 times 9.8. There, that's where we see the gravity. I'm going to need more room, so I'm going to end up erasing most of this. But the idea from here is that this object is hanging at rest. So the net force acting on this object should be the zero vector. Everything is in equilibrium. So that means that whatever T1 and T2 are, it has to be the case that T1 cosine 120 plus T2 cosine 30 is zero. And then same story for the second component. Whatever T1 and T2 are, we need T1 sine 120 plus T2 sine 30 minus 5 times 9.8 to give us zero. Okay, so let me erase most of what I don't need. I rearrange this. Okay, so I've saved that net force vector. The angles in this problem are really nice. So we know what cosine of 120, sine 30, etc. are, so I can go ahead and substitute those in. Cosine 120 is negative 1/2, cosine 30 is square root of 3 over 2, sine 120 is square root of 3 over 2, and sine 30 is 1/2. Okay, so I plug those in, we're going to have a pretty nice system of equations to work with. Again, the guiding principle for the rest of the problem is that because this object is hanging at rest, the net force should be the zero vector. That gives us a system of two equations for the two unknowns. We don't know T1 or T2, but luckily we have two component equations that we can use to solve for them. So just based on the x coordinate, I can say that T1 times 1/2 must be equal to T2 squared root of 3 divided by 2. That's from setting the x component equal to 0. Okay, multiply both sides by 2 and we get a nice equation relating T1 and T2. So T1 is T2 times square root of 3. Okay, let's look at the y coordinate. We have a little bit more there because that's where gravity showed up. So the y coordinate needs to satisfy that T1 times the square root of 3 over 2 plus T2 over 2 must be equal to 49. Okay, same story as before. Let's multiply everything by 2 and we get T1 square root of 3 plus T2 equals 98. Now I'm going to use the fact that T1 equals T2 times the square root of 3. So here I've taken T2 square root of 3 and plugged it in for T1. Now we have an equation just for T2. And in fact, it's a really nice one because T2 times the square root of 3 squared is just going to be 3T2. So we have 3T2 plus T2 is 98, so 4T2 is 98. That means that T2 is 24.5 newtons. So that's the tension in the second chord, the chord on the right. Using our relationship between T1 and T2, I can say that T1 is square root of 3 times that, so T1 is 24.5 times the square root of 3 newtons. This concludes this lecture on modeling force using vectors. So some of the main ideas are that the net force acting on an object is the sum of all of the individual forces. And then when you're looking at force problems, you have separate equations for the x component and the y components. The x components and the y components don't affect each other. make sure you use gravity correctly. And keep in mind that any vector can always be written as the product of a length times a unit vector pointing in the same direction. So if you don't know everything about some mysterious vector, it might be helpful to decompose it into a magnitude and a sense of direction. I hope you enjoy solving these problems. Thank you for your attention.